Hello, everyone. We're just a few minutes from our service, so please enjoy the next few minutes there at your homes, and we'll get started here directly.
Good morning, everyone. Glad you're watching, and we're excited to be here this Easter, and excited to get our program going here from First Christian Church in Purdy. If you're new to us, and especially if you're new to us and you live in our community, we're right across from Adelita's in Purdy. So if you, after our stay at home directive is over, if you want to come visit us, we sure love that. We meet each Lord's Day at 10:30, so we'll be right here. As far as what we're doing this morning, we're really excited to be having our Easter service. We'd really rather everybody was here. We missed you like crazy, but in any case, we're going to go forward and all together love the Lord this morning. So let's have our announcements up front so we can kind of go through those, and then we'll get our service started. Of course, we have our birthdays. I want to make sure we mention them this time. Linda Thomas had a birthday on the 4th. Sophia Ibarra had hers this last week. And let's see, there we go. And Angeline Vineyard had hers this last week. So did Joshua Vale. And then Michael Barkoff will have his on the 20th. So if you want to think of those folk and go back and maybe send them a card or give them a call and say, hey, I saw that you had a birthday. please do that. I know they'd love to hear from you. Michael and Carrie Barkoff celebrated their anniversary on the 1st of this month. So we have that. Then we have, when we get back into church, we're still anticipating that we'll be in service here as a congregation on April the 26th. So far, that is our anticipation. And when we do, we're going to have a Vacation Bible School lunch right after our morning meeting. So if you're a participant in that or want to be, we sure do want you to stay for a short lunch and a short meeting after our service on April the 26th. Of course, if you're thinking of visiting us, we do have a nursery that's provided each Sunday from birth to 2 years old. And my wife Tammy is kind of in charge of that. She's not always the one that takes care of it, but she's our head gal on taking care of the nursery. We do have youth group and Wednesday night Bible classes at 6 o'clock each Wednesday night. Of course, during this time of COVID-19, we just have them online and on this Facebook location. So be looking for that. This is just a short list. We like to run them past everybody that's here on our Sunday morning of our missions, those people that we support that are doing the work of the Lord around the world and here in our community. And also want you, if you're coming, don't forget to bring your drink tabs with you. We have a container in the foyer, and that goes to help Ronald McDonald House. And we do welcome you. We're glad you're here, and we're excited to get our service underway now. So the next thing we're going to look at is our memory work. We have started this just before the stay-at-home directive, so we're going to stick with it. During the Easter time, we've kept the same verses because I knew that we would be busy and probably be thinking about Easter a lot, and maybe you wouldn't do as much memory work. But in any case, we do want you to remember these verses. This is Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. And if you're at your homes and you can read behind me, I'll make sure I'm out of the way. If you can read behind me with me, read through this verse and keep trying to learn this verse. Read with me. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. Where do we find that? Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Very good. Next one is Philippians 4, 6, and 7. Philippians 4. Almost forgot. I've known this one for many moons. Philippians 4, 6, and 7. This one reads, read with me, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And again, where is that found? Philippians 4, 6, and 7. Very good. All right, let's begin our service. Let's bow and ask God to attend us and thank him for being with us. Father, we just do praise you and are so very thankful that you're in the house with us. We've been promised that wherever two or three are gathered together, there you are in our midst. And we know that it's very important for us to be together. And we're concerned because we do sense that this is a time when we're, for the protection of others especially, we're learning to participate apart. And so we ask that you'd be with us as we're gathered digitally right now. We just pray that you will help those that are watching in their homes and bless them, help them to sense a unity through Christ that we share. I pray, Father, that you would be with us as we love you this morning and receive from your word and from the message through the meeting that we have, songs, the Lord's Supper, all of the elements of our meeting. We just pray that you would bless and enable us to sense your presence and to stand with you and love you. Father, we pray that you will guide all the words that are said and the songs that are sung, that we may touch lives, we may touch hearts, and help people where they are. For we know that each person has his own burdens, and many may be having burdens that are quite heavy today. And we pray for each and every one of them, no matter who they are or where they are. We pray for them, God, that you would lift their burden and help them to sense your presence and to get the ministry of the Spirit that they need. We ask for these things in the blessed name of Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Blessed be your name.
Down just a little bit, but it can kind of. Let's see what we're doing. Okay. Probably did. Back it up just a little. Okay. You at home, if you want to get your communion supplies out, your juice, your crackers, and we'll go through a piece of scripture this morning. A very favorite of mine, and when I knew that Jim would be leading us in How Great Thou Art this morning, I thought, wow, this is going to fit in good. Listen to this passage of scripture and just see if it challenges you and at the same time gives you a great deal of confidence. Listen to this. It's from Philippians, the second chapter. Therefore, if there is any encouragement in Christ, I would think on Resurrection Sunday, wouldn't you? Therefore, if there's any encouragement in Christ, if there's any consolation of love, if there's any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and compassion, make my joy complete by being of the same mind, maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Do nothing from selfish or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Wow, that's a challenge, isn't it? But do not merely look out for your own interests, but also for the interests of others. Man, that's a big challenge. It almost doesn't seem fair, does it? Except for this next line. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant, and being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also, doesn't say resurrection here, but you know what is meant here. For this reason also, God highly exalted him, did not merely raise him from the dead, but exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's pray together as we prepare to take the elements of the Lord's Supper. Father, we thank you so much for this good news that Jesus has come, that he came from heaven, gave up everything that was his, every right, every privilege, and became a man like we are and suffered as a man. With this exception to his behavior, he did not sin. And we're so thankful that in his sinlessness there was great love and compassion that saw us in our need and agreed to become for us a curse that we might have eternal life. Wow. We thank you so much, God, that you were willing that he be put to death and that he, suffering the condemnation that we deserved, died for us and is now living with you on high and in our hearts. And we're so glad that we know him and love him. He is ours and we are his. We pray today that as we take the bread to ourselves and the cup, that you would cause us to understand that it is Jesus himself that comes, that is blessing us, that is giving himself, and that we participate in by this sign, by this event. We pray that our sense of this will stretch beyond this place here, and that it will go to all the places where my voice is heard today, and all the places beyond that where people are participating. And help us to remember that we, the church, we sup together until the day of Jesus coming universally. through time and all place and everywhere. Help us to accept our brotherhood and our love for one another wherever we dwell, and help us stick with each other and take care of each other, and help this to be part of what we understand today in this meal. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Jesus, as he was eating with his disciples, took the bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In like manner, after he took the cup and he said, "This is the blood of my covenant, which is shed for the forgiveness of many." Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. We're offering this morning, we have, I want to include our address up here so you can see it. I want to make sure you can see that. I bet we're not where you can see it yet. There you go. We have established a post office box for that purpose, so that if you wish to send your offering in by mail, then you may do so. And before we conclude the offering time, let's just take time to pray for the offerings received, that God will use them greatly in his kingdom. Father, we thank you for the time that we can give and return to you a portion of what we've been blessed with. We ask, Father, that you would take of our wherewithal of the money that we bring to you, and that you would use it. You'll spread it to those that need it. And Father, we pray that you would additionally reach out. Use this money in such a way that your name gets to be known, and that people come to love you and obey you, for you deserve it. In Jesus' name, amen. Next, we're going to do our responsive reading. And we'd encourage you to, at your home, to go along with us and just read along as we do the responsive reading. We'll be, what did I do with the clicker? There we go. We'll be reading from Luke, the 24th chapter, 36 through 48. So, while they were telling these things, he himself stood in their midst and said to them,
Peace be to you.
But they were startled and frightened and thought that they were seeing a spirit. And he said to them,
Why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your hearts?
See my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have.
And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet.
While they still could not believe it, because of their joy and amazement, he said to them,
Have you anything here to eat?
They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it before them. Now he said to them,
These are my words which I spoke to you while I was still with you. that all things which are written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled.
Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them,
Thus it is written that the Christ would suffer and rise again from the dead the third day,
and that repentance for forgiveness of sins would be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem.
You are witnesses of these things.
Very good. Now we're going to have a special number that has been supplied to us by Sandy Hall. So if you'll just sit tight and listen, Sandy is actually, she phoned this in, you might say. She brought her phone to me with this on it, and we transferred it to our computer, and so now you'll be able to hear Sandy as she sings.
Yeah.
While we kind of rewind right through Sandy's song for just a minute, we're going to move around our camera so that you can see our pictures that we're going to show throughout the sermon time. And You probably know that Sandy's watching this. You could probably say, "Hey, Sandy, you did great. Just put that on your screen. She might like that." I think you did great, Sandy. That was awesome. Just a minute or two more here to get everything really true and square. Probably close to as good as we're going to get here, Tam. If you want to kind of look at it while I speak, then that'll be great. The title of my sermon this morning is Resurrection. Why I can go on. And there's a lot to that. Whenever I think of the things in my life that strengthen me, Easter is a big one. And one of the things that I needed to take time to do with you before we get going this morning on the sermon itself, there's an old response that actually the First Christian Church in Webb City taught me. And I just love it, so I've tried to use it everywhere I go. And it goes like this. I say, Christ is risen, and you say, he is risen indeed. You say that back to me. So let me say that to you this morning where you are, and then you just say it back to me out loud where you are. It won't embarrass anybody but the dog. So I'll say it again. Christ is risen, you say, he is risen indeed. One more time. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Very good. That's great. At least everybody that's here, which is, wow, a big five of us. All of us understood and did it well, so I hope you did too. And I'm excited today to present to you news about Jesus' resurrection. Some things that hopefully that you've thought all along, but that need to be undergirded perhaps. Or maybe something new will occur to you as we look at the story of his resurrection. And of course, you remember Friday, don't you? That's what's on the screen behind me. I'll be out of the screen some today and in front of it some as well. But I want you to be able to see these old paintings that very helpfully illustrate what happened those days. And in this one, we see the crucifixion. We see where Christ has been put upon the cross, and he is hanging there, bleeding at his last. And that everybody kind of remembers, that awful, terrible, dark Good Friday when Jesus was crucified. And then the grief that followed. We took time to kind of notice that grief a lot yesterday morning. Something that I hadn't really done before in my ministry, where I just took time out of our schedule on Saturday and thought about the disciples and the depth of their grief having lost their master, and how
awful that must have been, but we that's what we did for our devotional yesterday, and I really enjoyed getting to do that for you. And of course, we've had an awful lot of services throughout, devotional services since Wednesday night. I think there's something like 6 or 8 of them that we've done since Wednesday night. So we wanted to keep in tune with this passage of Jesus' life, and then, of course, as we say, the grief of the disciples. I want you to keep looking at these pictures. If I leave them up, you keep looking at them, study them, think about them, what they mean, what they portend. Now I'm going to read through the scripture, and I'll stop and comment as we go along. This is from John, the 20th chapter. And remember your painting here, where that expresses so much grief and sorrow. And now John writes, he says, "Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene, whom you may remember had been cleansed of demons and had followed Jesus so lovingly, now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came early to the tomb while it was still dark." So, and the reason there are three people in this picture is because while John says it this way, you're going to get a clue in a couple of verses that actually there were other people with her. And if you look at the other passages of Scripture, you're going to find that, in fact, the other records show that there were two other women with Mary on her way to the tomb that day. So that's a fascinating study to find out how all that works out. We won't go into it much, but do know that while it says Mary here, in just a minute, she's going to say we, the plural, the first person plural. So you know there was more than just her going to the tomb that day. Here they are again. And so she goes, I need to go back and kind of get on track with our story. "Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came early to the tomb while it was still dark and saw the stone already taken away from the tomb." So there's the tomb stone. It's already moved away. "So she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved," which is John, in case you wondered. It's Peter and John. "Came to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, 'They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him.'" There it is. But she reports that there was more than just her that went. So this is her news. This is her first news. We don't know where he is. Not Jesus is alive, but we don't know where he is. Nobody gets it yet. They don't understand that he's been raised from the dead. Instead, they think, whatever, you know, somebody's taking him. So that's what this verse alludes to. That's their not knowing it. "So Peter and the other disciple went forth, and they were going to the tomb." And I've always loved this painting by Bernand. It's just a wonderful painting of fear and hope is what I think of when I see this painting. It's hard for me, touches me so much whenever I see it. And you're going to see the whole painting in just a frame or two. But it's a study of their faces here that I really like. "The two were running together," Peter and John. "The two were running together, and the other disciple ran ahead faster than Peter and came to the tomb first." This always amuses me in a way. It's just sort of like, is John really that competitive that he has to tell about, "Hey, we ran to the tomb and I got there first." "The two were running together, and the other disciple ran ahead faster than Peter and came to the tomb first." Here you see the whole painting, and it's a wonderful little study of their faces and of the emotion as they raced on the way to the tomb, not raced with each other so much as they were both racing to the tomb and stooping in and looking in. When they get there and stooping and looking in, he saw that as John, he got there first, and stooping and looking in, he saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Now you can imagine Peter, What kind of a guy is he? What's he going to do when he gets there? And so Simon Peter also came, following him, and entered the tomb. And he saw the linen wrappings lying there. So he notices the linen wrappings lying there. And I'm not sure this is a real good picture of it, because I get the impression that the headpiece, which you're going to get in the scripture here in a second, the headpiece was rolled up neatly, not like somebody had stolen the body, you know. So that's what we see here in verse 7. And the face cloth, which had been on his head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. So that's what Peter sees when he comes rolling into the tomb. So the other disciple, that's John, so the other disciple who had first come to the tomb then also entered, and he saw and believed. But what did he believe? See, I always kind of read through this and I said to myself, oh, we finally got it. Jesus is alive from the dead. But read the next verses as you go along here. What did he actually believe? For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. I don't think they really got it even yet. They were beginning to. The light was beginning to dawn. And this is one of the great things about reading your Bible and thinking about, well, now, how does this relate to real life? Is this like real life? And, you know, it really is. It's people, when they get a bit of great news, wonderful, life-changing news, it doesn't necessarily just turn the lights on immediately. They have to think about it a bit. They have to go through an acceptance period. And certainly the disciples did. The apostles and the rest of the disciples had to go through this acceptance period. So verse 10 says, so the disciples went away again to their own homes. But Mary was standing outside the tomb weeping. And so as she wept, she stooped and looked into the tomb. Now here's our other party, Mary. And I take it that, at least for this part, the other women may have been present as well, for they also saw an angel inside the tomb. And you're going to see that in just a minute. But Mary was standing outside the tomb weeping, and so as she wept, she stooped and looked into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and one at the feet where the body of Jesus had been lying. So there you see the two angels there as she stoops down and looks in, and she can see them. And they said to her, so these are not inanimate. Those in this painting almost look inanimate. They were not, because they knew that she was there. And they said to her, woman, why are you weeping? She said, because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him. So she doesn't believe yet. She just thinks somebody has robbed the tomb and has Jesus somewhere. And so that's what she says. When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there and did not know that it was Jesus. So out of the corner of her eye, or maybe not looking up, she just sees this person, and she thinks it's a gardener, as we'll see. Jesus said to her, woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, and here's another painting, nice one of her, kind of addressing him almost as maybe a gardener and begging him for information. Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away. Here's another more pathetic, and I don't mean that in a pejorative way. I really, you know, when you use the term pathetic, sometimes it can be, you just feel so much. And that's what this painting is like. It's very, you know, you have that great feeling of grief and loss, and you cannot figure what has happened to the body of this loved one of mine. And there she is begging. Jesus said to her, while she was in this condition, Jesus said to her, Mary. And you know, that's beautiful, because sometimes when you're calling one another to your senses, so to speak, you just use their name, you know. And that name is like we used to say in the 70s and 80s when we had CB radios, everybody had a name, but what we called it was a handle. Remember that? So it was old school people. We remember having a handle. Well, that's because when you reach out and want to get somebody's attention, that's what you use, their name. It's like a handle. And Jesus does this. He says to her, Mary. And she knows that. The use of her handle by her Lord. She understands. And she turned to him and said to him in Hebrew, Rabboni, which means teacher. And so she knows immediately who it is, because there he says her name in such a way that she knows who it is, you know. And such a beautiful, beautiful moment. Jesus said to her, stop clinging to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I ascend to your Father, or to my Father, and to your Father, and your Father, and my God, and your God. Mary Magdalene came, announcing to the disciples, I have seen the Lord, and that he had said these things to her. And so, in a certain sense, Mary Magdalene, of all people, becomes the first one to know that Jesus is alive from the dead, and she becomes, in a certain sense, the first evangelist, because she goes and tells the good news. And that's all we have of that story, but I have much more to say. And I want to encourage you to think with me this morning on this story, because we can see that in this story, Jesus is just being understood to be alive. It's not really full-blown, and people are still scared. And you will read this, if you read your Gospels, you'll see that the Gospel has not really taken its full-fledged power yet, because the people are still scared. They're scared of the authorities. The authorities just killed their leader. They were in charge of Jesus' death. They saw to it that he died. And what would make them think that they were safe? And really, truly, they were not safe, because the authorities, as you would see if you read the book of Acts, you would see that they had it in for them. I'm reading to you from Acts just now because I want you to see how things change. I want you to see what happens when a person begins to really understand at last that Jesus is alive from the dead. It changes their whole approach in life. This is what the Apostle Peter, 49 days later, this is what the Apostle Peter says. He says this, what he says to over 3,000 people. We know it's at least 3,000, because 3,000 were baptized that day. So he says this to at least 3,000 people. He stands up and he says, This Jesus God raised up again, to which we are all witnesses. Therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured forth this which you both see and hear. For it was not David who ascended into heaven, but he himself says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. That's a psalm that we'll go over here in a minute. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ. Get this Jesus whom you crucified. Sound scared anymore? Don't sound much like he's frightened anymore. Sounds like he's completely got it. That finally, at last, he knows that Jesus is alive from the dead, and everything else is about serving him. Everything else is about serving him. And I wanted to let you know that. Then I want to take you a little bit further in Peter's life. He's gone on. I'm not quite sure how many years or months this goes on, but eventually God wants the Gentiles to know for sure that they are in. And so he sends Peter to the house of Cornelius. And this is the speech that Peter gives at the house of Cornelius. I want you to hear it all, but I especially want you to be attentive at the end. See what he proclaims on the basis of this resurrected Christ that he serves. He says, I most certainly understand now that God is not one to show partiality, but in every nation, the man who fears him and does what is right is welcome to him. The word which he sent to the sons of Israel, preaching peace through Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. You yourselves know the thing which took place throughout all Judea, starting from Galilee after the baptism which John proclaimed. You know of Jesus of Nazareth, how God appointed him with the Holy Spirit and with power, and how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are all witnesses of the things he did, both in the land of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They also put him to death by hanging him on a cross. God raised him up on the third day and granted that he become visible, not to all the people, but to witnesses who were chosen beforehand by God. That is to us who ate and drank with him after he arose from the dead. And he ordered us to preach to the people and solemnly to testify that this is the one who has been appointed by God as judge of the living and the dead. Of him all the prophets bear witness that through his name everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins. Peter goes from not really fully comprehending who his master is to finally realizing that his crucified master has been raised from the dead. Yes, and much, much more than that for Peter, because we actually went through this earlier in our week about how Peter had been restored, really, by Jesus. In the last chapter of John, you can read about how three times Christ asked him about his love for him, and really gives Peter three chances to come around against the denials that he had made. And we'll go into all that discussion, but you can see that Peter comes this long distance because he's next to Christ. He knows Christ, he knows him personally, and he has this tremendous respect and love for him. And I'm going to use Psalm 2 because I want you to see what Peter actually referred to in his sermon before the people on the day of Pentecost. One of the references he makes is from this psalm. Maybe you'll pick up on it as I go through. I'm just going to go through this psalm because I think this is what we call a messianic psalm. That is, it refers to Jesus. Psalm, the second chapter, says, why are the nations in an uproar and the peoples devising a vain thing? The kings of the earth take their stand and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, does this any of this sound familiar? Do you ever feel this way sometimes yourself? Let us tear their fetters apart and cast away their cords from us. He who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord scoffs at them. Then he will speak to them in his anger and terrify them in his fury, saying, but as for me, I have installed my king upon Zion, my holy mountain. I will surely tell of the decree of the Lord. He said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will surely give you the nations as your inheritance, and the very ends of the earth as your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron. You shall shatter them like earthenware. Now, therefore, O kings, show discernment. Take warning, O judges of the earth. Worship the Lord with reverence, and rejoice with trembling. Do homage to the Son, that he not become angry and you perish in the way, for his wrath may soon be kindled. How blessed are all who take refuge in him. Now, I hope that's the kind of an attitude that you have with respect to Jesus and your confidence in him, what kind of times we may face. You may say to yourself, well, but I'm not a prophet of the Old Testament, and I'm not an apostle. No, but you know, there is a person who has written a piece since the times of the apostles that I think kind of shows the sort of courage. And he certainly faced very difficult times. He was nearly executed at one point. And and went through a great deal of persecution for his stand for Jesus Christ. And his name is Martin Luther, and he wrote this little thing. A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing, our helper he amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe does seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate on earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. We're not the right man on our side, the man of God's own choosing. Dost ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth, his name, from age to age the same, and he must win the battle. And though this world, with devils filled, should threaten to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath willed his truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fell him. That word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them abideth. The spirit and the gifts are ours through him who with us sideth. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also. The body they may kill, God's truth abides still. His kingdom is forever. Brothers and sisters, that's what got to be known on Easter Day, some nearly 2,000 years ago, when Jesus rose up from the grave. Today, we're using as a kind of a hymn of dedication. Usually we have an invitation here at our church, but today we don't have a lot of folk here, so we're going to call it a hymn of dedication. And I want you to think about Jesus as we sing this song, and if you know it, you can sing with us, and I'd love to have you do that. I'm going to get out of the way so you can see the words. God sent his Son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is set to prove my Savior lives. Because he across the river,
Today, and God bless you as the day wears on, and you don't forget, you know, that Jesus has been raised from the dead, and that you have your Savior who loves you so very much, living on high, and that you can rely on Him, and you will get all that you need. That's our promise, and I just pray that you'll have that confidence in each day as you go along. Let's take time and address these things to God, and then we'll close our service with the doxology. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the love that you've bestowed upon us with the raising of Jesus from the dead, that you did not merely die and leave us here to contemplate the meaning of his death, but you proclaimed him, your Son, the Messiah, the King, the Anointed One, the Prince of all, through the power of him being raised from the dead. We thank you so much, God, for doing that, for giving us this Easter time, this time when we celebrate the resurrected Christ Jesus. We pray, Father, that you'll give us great confidence. Confidence like Peter had. Fearlessness, knowing what you want us to do and just standing firm and doing it no matter what. I pray, Father, that you will fill us with courage to tell and to love for those who are around us, so that they might get to know this beautiful Savior who loves us so and will forgive sin and lead people like you and me to heaven, where we will dwell forever. Father, please save many through us, we ask. Help us to enter the fray and be unafraid. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all for being here today.
Praise God from.
We're going to sing our doxology just now. Tammy's got it. She's on it. Let's sing with her. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Have a beautiful day, y'all.